So soliloquy had this postscript that went, if every word spoken in New York City daily were somehow to materialize as a snowflake, each day there'd be a blizzard. I mean, I love the idea of language accumulating like snow. And just before I wrote soliloquy, there was this huge blizzard in New York. It was one of the worst ever. And when it snows in New York, what they do is they scoop up the snow and they load it onto trucks and they dump it into the river where it dissolves, flowing back into the ocean. And I thought, if speech was materialized as snow, at the end of the day, they would have to do the same thing with all that language. They'd collect it and they'd shovel it into trucks and dump it into the river in order to make it melt away into the ocean and just start again the next day. Which reminds me of a story of Rabelais. And it was a story he told about a battlefield that was so cold that on the day of the battle, even the sounds of the battle froze and fell to the ground. And there they lay all winter long until spring, when the frozen sounds began to melt. And as they melted, the sounds were replayed, not in the order in which they were originally made, but the order in which they melted. It was a cacophony. But certain people on this battlefield picked up these sounds before they melted, and they brought them into an ice cellar where they remained frozen for centuries. And when they finally thawed, sounds were heard from 600 or 700 years ago. Which reminds me of this very dear friend of mine, who's a very successful painter and a very wealthy man. And when you make that kind of money, you trade paintings for wine. But the problem is that he loves wine, but his wife doesn't drink. So his greatest joy is to invite his friends over to his house, where he just starts taking out these incredible bottles that are worth hundreds of dollars, simply because he's just dying to share his wine with someone. It really is just the most amazing thing. It's great going over to this guy's house. And I remember him taking out a bottle of port from the early 1800s. And it wasn't the best port I ever drank. But the idea that I was drinking a liquid from over 200 years ago was completely incredible. And I find all of these things fluid, rife with history. I find the materiality of liquid, or the materiality of sound, or the materiality of language, to be interchangeable with words taking so many forms. And maybe this is why I love digital language so much. I love the way that the digital has liquidated language. You know, I've often thought of the metaphor of the water cycle that describes the ways in which language moves throughout the digital ecosystem, from frozen solid artifacts like movies, right, to flowing liquid states like torrents that was floating around. And sometimes they're slushy, partially frozen, partially melted, like when you're simultaneously playing an MP3 while it's seeding a torrent up to the cloud. Even the metaphors that we use to describe the digital ecosystem are atmospheric and weather-inspired. I love the idea that, like urine, we stream our media. Like dollies and watches, when we play MP3s, they unfurl, they melt, they loosen, they lessen, they deflate, they soften. But no matter how hot my computer gets, it never actually softens, nor does it sweat or wet itself. I sometimes half expect to pick up my laptop after a long session and find a pool of liquid beneath it, and I'm always disappointed to find that it's bone dry. It hates water, and it hates grease. And yet its surfaces are slathered with both. Morsels of croissant drop into the valleys, and they get ground into smaller crumbs each time I punch my keys and write my poems. and specks of saliva fling from my lips and land on my screen. They dry there, waiting until I pick them off with my fingernails. Desiccated sweat from the heels of my hand create these ghost-like washes on either side of my trackpad. Stray eyelashes fall between my arrow keys and are devoured by my machine's ears. And if you hold my Android up to the light in just the right way, you can see my sweat pattern, created by the grease from my finger that's been run in the same shape so many times that it might as well have been channeled into stone. And from time to time, I wipe my pattern away, but moments later, it reappears again when I run my finger back over it to unlock my phone. And my device is only a phobic layer. Sits atop Gorilla Glass, and like my skin, it wears out and dries, loses its lubrication. Bone buckles and crack, brittle with age and eaten away by the acidity of my sweat. My device is in an eternal state of undress. My finger no longer glides, it skitters, resisting my touch rather than courting it. And I reach for a tube of grease and a Q-tip, and with a circular motion, I caress its surface. Now newly moistened, my finger glides across its surface like an ice dancer traversing the ice. On hot summer evenings, driblets of sweat plunge from my brow onto my screen and slither over its rounded edges, saturating its ports. Lifting my device, I notice my desk is wet. I wipe it up, and then I wipe my brow. My device and I are one. I palm my keyboard until the letters wear off. Always A's, D's, S's, E's, and T's. Never P's, U's, C's, or V's. And if I continue pounding my machine at this rate, I won't have any letters left at all, just bare, unadorned, naked keys. So desperate, I purchase a skin impregnated with a smoothie silk lubricant for comfort and sensitivity, so thin, they say, that I won't know it's there. And I unbox it, using both my hands, and I unfurl it over my keyboard, form-fitting. It's powdery, and it smells like latex. And the next day, I return it to Amazon. And when they ask me why, I tell them that typing feels like having safe sex. Rust never sleeps. Flesh to machine, pixel to paper, and back again. I'll never forget how astonished my grandfather was in the 1970s when he first saw a fax machine. And he received this fax from my grandmother, who was at the time traveling abroad. And he was stunned. He said, how could someone's handwriting that he knew intimately, he'd even received letters from this handwriting, dematerialize and get sent over the phone lines and then reappear as an identical facsimile of what used to arrive in the post in the morning or on his pillow at night? You know, people say that technology makes us cold and separates us, but if my grandfather is any example, it's anything but that. His reaction to that primitive fax machine was hyper-emotional. Just think of all the invisible language right now, rife with emotion flowing through this room. Wi-Fi signals, text messages, radio waves, television transmissions. With every breath you take, the air is thick with language.